It's 11 o'clock.
A very good morning and warm welcome to all the participants, respected speaker of the day. Myself Mysura Reddy, student member for CSPCS and today's host for this webinar. The Central for Signal Processing and Communication Systems, whose motive is to provide high quality graduate and postgraduate training environment for next generation of researchers and support innovation based endeavors with an aim to promote a research culture amongst the students and faculties. On a primary note, I would like to thank Dr. MVV Prasad sir, in charge COE CSPCS, John Moses sir, faculty coordinator CSPCS, respected HOD of EC department, Professor Bree Srinivasu sir, and also would extend my thanks to our beloved principal Dr. Suresh Akela sir, administrative and non-administrative staff, and our college management for giving us this wonderful opportunity to conduct such webinars during this pandemic time. The Center for Signal Processing and Communication Systems welcomes you to the webinar on scope of AI-IoT post-COVID-19 by Dr. Sharnil Pandya, Associate Professor from Symbiosis International University. Sharnil sir also worked as Associate Professor in Navarashna University and is highly skilled in languages such as C, C++, SQL, HTML, Java. Sharnil sir, over to you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, so my screen is visible?
No, sir, I just given you the role as...
Yeah, so if you can just pass me that, yeah.
Yeah. I have passed you, sir. Kindly please check it.
Sure. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Hello, am I audible?
Sir, you are audible, sir. Please go on.
Yeah. So, good morning, everyone. This is my today's roadmap. So, today we are going to discuss some of the concepts of Internet of Things, cognitive Internet of Things, some of the IoT networking technologies, and some of the recent case studies. We'll talk about technologies like connecting cars, VANET, and different things. And then we'll discuss how these technologies can actually help post-COVID-19. So today we'll also discuss some of the demonstrations of how IoT and AI combining can assist us in developing different technologies. Before I start my session about IoT, I thought that I want to start with the basic fundamentals. So I want to ask one question to everyone, that what is internet according to you? I understand that everyone might think that this is a very silly question, that everyone knows what is internet. We all are using mobile apps and everything. But let me put my question in a different way. Just like we know that we can produce electricity. So we store water in reservoir, we put it on turbine, we move turbine and we produce electricity. My question is how internet is produced. So if anyone can answer. So we want to make it interactive so that we'll keep on discussing and you can ask me questions anytime during the session. So if anyone can tell me, like, according to you, what is internet? So you can even post your question, like, answers in a chat window, and maybe some of you can help me, like, what are the answers coming? So let me give you some options. What do you think? It's coming from satellite, it's coming from some radio frequency technologies, or something like LoRa networks, or from where actually it's coming? Or there is a widely known term, ISP, internet service provider. But again, my question is, who provides internet to ISP? So finally, the question comes to that, what is internet? So if anyone can help me.
A source of data which can be transferred or saved is called as internet, I think so.
Agree. So theoretically it's okay, but so practically how we are accessing internet? So how internet is coming to us?
Through signals, maybe infrared signal
signals,
or,
right? But sir,
yeah.
From somewhere it is coming, right? So from
yes.
Where it is coming, right? So I think it is very interesting truth about internet, actually. Just like if we have a computer lab and there are 20 computers and all the computers are connected via cables, similarly I'll say that the whole world is connected via cables. So basically I want to tell that internet is completely offline architecture. But the question is, in the world,
the question is, in the world
is water and one portion
is water
land.
And one portion is land.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yeah. Hello.
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 Please go on, sir.
Yeah, any question is there, you can. Shall I continue?
Yes, sir, absolutely.
So basically the three portion is water and one portion is land. So the question is that, have we actually installed cables underwater? So the answer is yes, actually. So if you look at this map, actually there is Atlantic Ocean map, and all the horizontal lines that you are seeing, those are actually installed cables underwater. So what I want to tell is, everything is connected via cables. That is the only way currently we are accessing internet. But the question is, who actually install cables? Which companies actually install cables like this? So if you can see this, the top towers are actually responsible for installing cables all over the world. So they actually divided different regions among them, and they actually install cables. So if I talk about India, there is a company called Flag, which actually install cables all over India. There is a company called Verizon, install cables in Australia and UK, and even Google has its own cable lines. And companies like Tata, Indicom, Reliance, actually they lease lines. They pay money to these people to lease their lines. Now these lines are actually connected to different network switches and routers, and then it is reaching our home. So that is how actually everything is connected. So I think now this concept is clear, that internet is completely offline architecture. Even though there is some research going on currently that people are working on satellite based internet. So there is a company called Speedigo actually in Ahmedabad providing satellite based internet, where there is a small dish we connect outside our house, which is connected to satellite. And there are some other technologies are right now going on, but still 95% internet that we access currently, that is offline. So now I want to come up with one more question. If everything is offline, then when you log into your Facebook account or Twitter account and you say that I'm online on Twitter, I'm online on Facebook, then what is online? So if anyone can help me, like, what do you mean by online here?
It means we are active.
We are active. So that's exactly right answer. So basically a connection from my computer to a Facebook server is active. So that green symbol in a chat window just explains me that I'm active, my connection is active, that's it. Otherwise, everything is offline, and this online is just a buzzword, just a marketing word used by companies for doing different marketing and just telling us that new technology has come, we are online and all. Otherwise, everything is offline, nothing is online. So I thought that before talking about IoT, I think I should talk about this kind of things, so that, because everything starts from internet, finally. Now, one more question I have. So if you can see three images on my screen, can you tell me what these different images are telling actually? There is no theoretical definition of IoT, but these three images are actually talking about IoT. So anyone, if you can help me, what these three images are actually trying to explain?
Things, people are connected through internet.
Okay, then? So what Sir is telling is right actually. So everything is started from internet of computers. Then we connected people with internet, with computers. When we did this, there were some devices like tube lights, fans, microwave, refrigerators. All these devices were not part of the network, and we tried to bring them within the network by providing some kind of Wi-Fi adapters, Bluetooth adapters, or some kind of networking technology. That is actually called Internet of Things. So basically, IoT is nothing but combination of Internet of Computers, Internet of People, and Internet of Things. But there is no theoretical definition of IoT. So IoT is just a concept where we are actually trying to integrate different things. So if you look at the screen, as per Cisco, actually 50 billion devices by 2020 will be connected by internet. But before I again talk about IoT, I want to play one of my video actually. This is almost a 10 years old video. And I want to clear one concept. What do you think that if I am controlling something using internet, can I say that particular product is IoT product? So if anyone can tell me that anything that is connected to internet is IoT? If anyone can just help me. Let's say if I give an example, if I'm controlling a fan or tube light using my mobile app, can I say it's an IoT product, that I'm using
yes.
some kind of IoT product which is controlling some kind of home automation, right? So what I'll do,
yes.
I'll quickly play one video. Yeah. So I'll quickly play one video and you just need to tell me that this particular product is IoT or not.
Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to see a live demo. So before we go further, what I mean, so let's start with one of the circuit in black that is called Arduino board. Basically, this circuit is connected with one more circuit, as you can see here. That is a Bluetooth adapter. So what we are going to do using Bluetooth, we are going to control home appliances. Now, this Arduino circuit is connected with one switchboard, or that is known as relay board. Now, the main function of relay board is it will alternate our power. So, if the power is on, it will make it off. If it is off, it will make it on. Now, that relay board is directly connected with the switchboard, as you can see. Now, what is our aim? Like, we wanted to use mobile to operate home appliances. And on the other end, we also want to use switch to operate home appliances. That's why we did some wiring arrangement and circuit design, as you can see here. Now, currently we have connected only one slot, that is a fan. Now, what I'm going to do, now we have designed one Android app. Now, using this app, I'm going to control the fan, as you can see, on the ceiling. And as you can see, currently it is off. But as soon as I send signal to this relay board, the fan will switch on. So this is our Android app, as you can see. And now I'll pass the signal. And as you can see, the fan is on. It will take some time because the signal is received by this relay board, and then relay board is sending signal to our original switchboard. Now we'll do the same experiment and we'll switch it off. So let's do it again. As you can see here, send signal and see in the real time the fan is off. Same process.
Yeah. So what I want to say is finally, can I say this particular product is IoT product?
Yes.
So can I say what I've tried to do controlling a particular appliance using my mobile app, can I say this is IoT?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll quickly play a couple of more videos and then we'll discuss that can we say these products are IoT or not. So there is one more video actually. I thought that rather than using mobile app, I'll try to use Google APIs. So try to give voice signals, and I want to operate different appliances. So I tried to do that. So I'll just try to play that video.
Today I'm going to similarly let's turn the AC off, and as you can see, the AC is turned off. Now we can do the same process using your voice. So what I have to do? I will pass on the voice signals instead of a button signals, and it will perform the same process.
Just a second. Please bear with me with the technical issue actually. So I'll quickly play the video again.
So let's see. Light on.
So what I'm trying here, I'm trying to use voice signals and I'm trying to operate this appliance.
Light off. AC off. Yes. By student demonstration, and because what we can also do is we can start both the devices together. So let's all devices on, as you can see the light, and you can see the AC. And again, what we can do, both the devices off, as you can see the light. Thank you.
Yeah, so this was an example that using voice signal, I'm trying to control different appliances. And then I thought that why to use a mobile app, but we don't have time. And every time I cannot remember that I need to carry my phone and I need to operate it. So I tried to do third experiment, that using motion based home automation system. I mean, I tried to use PIR sensor here, passive infrared sensor. And I thought that when I walk in my room, automatically appliance should be on. When I just walk off, it should be off. So just a quick video I'll play, and then we'll discuss that. Can we say all these things are IoT or not?
Already seen my live home automation demo where I will control different appliances like fan, tube lights,
so
and AC using mobile app.
So I have a small YouTube channel actually. So I'll share the link at the end. But currently, I'll just skip the introduction part and we'll directly move to the functioning part so that we can save time also.
A demo. This command. This is not digital. This command. It is human object motion. Based on my motion, all appliances will be switched on and switch off. So I'll not waste more time and let's go on the live demonstration. So if you see that, I'll just walk in this and automatically light in my room, and as you can see, fan in my room has already started.
So I'm just walking off here and
now,
you can see that everything is
off. Off in my room, and you see that different appliances in my room.
Right. So this was an example how motion-based home automation is working. Now, finally, I want to come back to the question that I asked, that can we say that anything that is connected to internet is IoT? So if anyone can help me. So I've shown you different examples like using voice signals, I'm controlling different appliances, using motion sensor, I'm doing that. And assume that it is using internet. Now, can I say this particular product is IoT?
No.
Why no?
Because for motion sensor, there is not required of internet, I think.
But sir, I'm using MQTT broker here. So IoT broker I'm using here. Then?
Okay.
Then can I say this is IoT?
Yes.
Okay. So now let me come back to the question I asked. Actually, all three videos that I've shown you, that is not IoT. IoT has certain set of rules that should be followed. Then only we can say this particular product is IoT. Then the question is, then what is this? If I'm controlling a home appliance, maybe tube light and fan using my mobile app. So what is actually happening? A machine like mobile is interacting with another machine like tube light. So it is M2M. It is machine to machine communication. It is not IoT. So there are so many different technologies that is around us, and people believe that people have wrong conception that this is IoT. That is not IoT actually. So before I talk about that, let me talk about other technologies that is around us. So one of the technology I discussed, that is M2M. When a machine is interacting with another machine, that is called M2M. That is not IoT. Then there is a buzzword in the market called Internet of Everything. There is nothing like that. That is just a marketing word, but actually nothing like that exists. One more thing is industrial internet that is used by lease lines and all by different companies. That is also not IoT. And there is one more thing, that different sensors are connected via internet, but that is not actual IoT, but that is called Web of Things. That is actually a subset of IoT. So that is also one of the part of IoT, but not the complete IoT product that I can say. So Web of Things actually is a subset of IoT, but then how to decide that particular product is IoT or not? So so before I talk about it, one more very important thing I want to discuss here, that we all are currently finding that technologies like IoT, data science and cybersecurity is going around. So in 2014, actually, a father of technology, Mr. Gartner, actually predicted something. So if you look at this map, this is called Plateau of Productivity. So this map actually talks about all the technologies that was invented in the last 50 years. So you talk about 3D printers, you talk about cloud computing, you talk about predictive analysis, everything is there. But according to him, now only three technology will last for the next 50 years. That is IoT, AI, and cybersecurity. And rest of the technology will see that in a couple of years, it will be obsolete. And if you look at this map, IoT is at the peak of this technology. So according to him, no other technology will survive. And only one technology is possible. Currently, research is going on for quantum computing. Recently, before some months, I think Google launched their own quantum computer. But that is still at research level, initial level is there. But there is something called quantum machine learning also started recently. In the last month, only quantum machine learning has started. But only these three technologies will survive. So for students specifically, you need to have skills in one of these areas. If you want to get jobs in a good company, then companies are looking for these skills only. So nowadays, doesn't matter you're studying from which university, you're studying from Symbiosis, Nirma, or from anywhere. If you have knowledge and skills, then you can survive. So finally, it's now playing fields are leveled. So doesn't matter. So only these technologies will last for the next 50 years, according to Gartner. I'm not telling that. That is according to Gartner. Now let's come back to the question I was discussing. Now how to decide that particular thing is IoT. So IoT has three parameters, very important. If you are sensing data using some sensors, now whatever we are sensing is autonomous, that is independent technology is there, something like edge computing is there, and the technology that we are sensing is actionable, then only we can say this particular product is IoT. So let me elaborate this thing. That is what I want to say is, let's say you connect a DHT11 sensor to just get temperature humidity of this room. Now I'm just getting that via some IoT broker and I'm storing that on cloud like Google Firebase. So that means I have three parameters here: sense, transport, and store. Then this particular product is not IoT. That is just M2M. A machine is interacting with machine. But if whatever information that is stored on Google Firebase, if I'm analyzing that information using some AI algorithm, I'm controlling it and sharing with some application, then only I can say that particular product is IoT. So if these six parameters are part of that product, then only we can say that is IoT. If that is not there, then that might be Web of Things. That might be, as I said, M2M or industrial internet, or different things are there, or Internet of Everything. That is just a buzzword. But these six parameters are the most crucial ones to tell that particular product is IoT. I'll also discuss some of the research papers I've published on different IoT products. So I'll discuss those things also. And also discuss the actual architecture of IoT and how we can say that this particular product is IoT, or how to do different research on that. But before I begin with that, I want to discuss that one thing is very crucial, that generally when students come to me, they talk about fancy ideas and all. Basically, so many problems are lying around us. Just like I talk about this home automation. Just today morning, I was facing one issue that when I tried to play a video during webinar, I was not able to, you will not be able to hear that audio of the video that I'm playing. You can hear me. So via microphone, I'm speaking, right? But when I'm playing that video is actually getting played in my local machine. So to transmit that audio, I need some amplifier or external speaker. So what I did, I transmitted all the videos that I'm playing currently on my mobile app. So I've connected my mobile with additional speaker And using that speaker, actually, you can hear that audio. That's why sometimes, you know, that syncing is not happening. That video I'm playing here, but then the voice is not syncing because I'm doing it at different places. So I need to sync that. I need to practice that. Then only this is possible. But somehow I thought that let me find some solution. It cannot happen that there is some problem and we should not find the solution. So whenever you are looking for different projects around you, you should actually look for some real-time problem. Rather than looking for fancy ideas, try to find some problem that is around you. Always we'll find a lot of problems around us. And try to solve that problem, automatically research will happen. And automatically you'll find a good product or you'll find a commercial product from that. Right. So these are six parameters that's very important to talk about it. Now there is one more concept now in IoT. Actually, IoT is pretty old technology now. Actually, it was invented in 1988. But it came in India in 2010, actually. So we all know that like we are 10 to 20 years behind. But now there is a new technology that is emerged that's called cognitive Internet of Things. And there is a bridge between IoT and cognitive IoT, that is cognitive computing. But before I talk about cognitive computing, I want to ask one more question here. What is the difference between a human and machine? What a human can do, a machine cannot. So if anyone can just help me, just the basic difference between human and machine.
Like human can change his, human can change his versions from this to this, but the machine works on a preset programming so that it cannot think on its own.
Okay. So what he's telling is right, actually. So basically, human has cognitive ability. When I talk about cognitive ability, that is, we can see, we can sense, we can hear, we can speak, we can smell. That ability is not a machine is having. But still, having said that, we know that machine can do 10,000 calculations in a second. But still, we need to invent something like machine learning. Why? Because we have that neural network in our body, which is connected to our brain. So if anything is happening to my leg, my brain is controlling, taking care of that thing. But when the same thing is happening to a machine cannot take decisions on its own. That's why we need to design artificial neural network and give it to machine. That's why we call it machine learning. We need to make the machine learn. Now here, what is happening is whatever data we are dealing with, so structured data, or it could be unstructured like multimedia, audio, video, images, tree, graph, all those things. When we combine that with machine learning algorithm, then it creates a new technology that is called cognitive computing. And when I want to transmit this using IoT via some cloud server to some application, I'll call it cognitive Internet of Things. So rather than talking more theoretically, let me play one video so that we can understand that how actually this thing is working. So I'm going to play one video. That video is of actually product called iTribe actually. This was one of the top 10 products of United States. And this video actually I used to play in front of my students before 5 years actually. So this product came in 2015 actually. And that is using eyes to control different things. So let me play this video.
The ability to sense our attention. Eye tracking will change this. It will enable you to interact with devices in ways you only dreamed was possible. Our vision is to transition eye tracking an expensive lab equipment into everyday products. Soon, this technology will be integrated into a wide range of devices, such as tablets and smartphones. Today, you can get started with the iTrack tracker. This device can tell where someone is looking with precision about the size of the fingertip. Devices will behave more intuitively. Games will become more immersive. It's the world's first affordable eye tracking device that contains some of the very latest technology. Bundled with the device comes our software development. With just a few lines of code, perhaps we'll start to receive a real-time stream of iCord. We're really looking forward to seeing what people around the world have built this. Pre-order your development kit today and be among the first to get your eyes on this exciting technology.
So, can anyone tell me how this product is working actually? Because you've seen that we are controlling different things using our eyes. So, if anyone can help me. So, let me explain actually. If I'm using my screen, that screen is actually 2D. So it has X and Y coordinates. What we need to do here when we use this product actually captures us. So they actually captures that where we are looking. So generally, if you remember now, when we are playing window middle player, that middle button would be there to play and pause. Similarly, if I'm reading a book on Amazon, and if I'm reading ebook, then on my right hand corner of the page, there is something called next. So this particular product is actually observing us where we are looking. And based on that, it is capturing coordinate. There is machine learning algorithm which captures that, and automatically this product sync with a human being, and then it starts working. It requires training initially, but then this product works 95% accuracy this product is having. Actually, I bought this product actually, and you'll be surprised to know the cost of this product is only $100. So only 10,000 rupees, less than a smartphone cost, this product is available in the market. Yeah. So one more video actually I want to play. That is about, there is one sensor available. That sensor can actually identify different products. So whether it is medicine or whether it is food product or even your car tire or anything, this sensor can actually identify the actual level, or I can say that if I'm putting that optical ray on a fruit, that will tell me that this fruit is fresh or not. So that kind of things we can do using this sensor. So I'll quickly play this.
Hi. First, I'll measure an apple. I'll shine an apple in the apple with the device, wait a couple of seconds, and then in a few seconds I get the response on my cell phone. It says 13.5 grams per 100 grams of carbohydrates and 61 calories per 100 grams for this apple. Next, we'll measure a cheese. This is a cheese to the supermarket. I take the device, shine light for about 2 seconds, then wait a few more seconds, and I'll get the response on our cell phone. You can see it says 28.4 grams per 100 grams of fat, 1 gram of carbohydrates, and 23.8 grams of protein, and 333 calories per 100 grams. That matches quite exactly the label on this cheese. Now I'm going to show how we can use our device to identify pills. Let's take one pill for example. This is Advil PM. I open the case and take out the pill. Place one inside and then use our device to identify the pill. I simply tap on the cell phone. Takes about 2 seconds to measure, and we get the identification on the screen. As you can see, that identified it as Advil PM or Pfizer. Next, let's take a random pill and use our device to identify it. We wait a couple of seconds and should see the result on the screen. Was identified as aspirin. This is our current prototype, and we are now ready to move into the fabrication of our first product, the style.
So again, one more question, how this product is working, if anyone can help me.
Sir, maybe the detailed information of every product, like he's testing with every product, right? So maybe the detailed information of every product has been already written into the device, so that like the properties, the flavor, etc. So like when tries to go check it further, so it is going to check all libraries or repositories, and it is finding the exact, like it is balancing both the things and it is giving us the result.
Okay, so what you're telling is right. Actually, it is using molecule sensors. Already molecule sensors are available. So when we are putting that optical ray on a product, now it is extracting information. That information in a fraction of a second is going on a cloud. Now there is AI algorithm. It analyzes the information, connect with the database that they are already having, that properties and all. It is telling that which medicine and everything. But still, it's amazing that in a fraction of a second, I can come to know which medicine is this. Sometimes we forget that the medicine box or that strip is not available, and some medicine is there in a box or something, and we can easily identify. So such solutions are right now is a need of a day, need of the hour actually, that we need to work on interdisciplinary things and try to work out some solutions. So what I've found personally, when I started working on IoT, generally I started writing different papers in different areas only. I've written papers in environmental science, in solar energy, in mechanical engineering, chemical engineering. I found that less novelty is there in computer science and engineering. If I apply IoT in my field, there is just system integration. I'm just connecting sensor with controller and I'm storing data on a cloud. And that is not difficult. Anyone who look at a couple of YouTube videos can do that. Even right now in schools, they are being taught all this curriculum and all these things are being taught to school in schools actually. They know how to use Arduino, Raspberry Pi, NodeMCU. All the things they already know. But the thing is, they cannot actually work on real-time problems. That is where engineering students are there. That you guys are future of India, that you need to work, find such solutions for the people who are coming. For example, that COVID-19, currently it is there. So a couple of things I tried for that and we'll discuss in the further slides actually. Now, let's talk about some theoretical stuff. Now, one more thing I want to talk about, that I cannot just keep on playing this kind of videos in my class. That is not okay. We need to balance both the things, the core fundamentals part as well as the application part. So that updated part should be there definitely, but without fundamentals, nothing will exist. Just like we discussed, what is internet? That is very basic fundamental. That is not an engineering question actually. Even 10th and 12th who is studying in schools should know that, how internet is working. Because every day everybody is using internet and this generation actually using internet everywhere. So what I'm finding is also that they're very good in using gadgets. I think my students are 10 times more better than me in using different smart gadgets. But when I ask them how this thing is getting done, that is where they struggle. So basically, I feel that they need to read more. They need to read more research papers or more articles and blogs to understand that how particular thing is working. Right. So we'll discuss some more things later if time permits, like what is 1G, 2G, or how core is working, what is dual core. So what is core inside that processor? So all these things are the fundamentals that I'm talking about. Now let's talk about IoT here. Now IoT has four different layers. So you know that we need sensors. So first layer is sensing layer. So sensors or actuators will work at this layer. Then using some networking technology like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, LoRa networks, RFID, near field communication will send data towards some cloud. So let's say cloud is like Google, Firebase, AWS. There are so many different cloud platforms are available. Then I have some AI algorithm which analyzes that information. And that analyzed information is we are representing on application. Now the question is why we need to do that. If I can directly store information on cloud and directly I can connect that with some kind of app. But here the actual concept is different. What sensors are actually getting now, that is raw data. But end user is not interested in raw data. So if I take one example, let's say if I'm using DHT11 sensor, I'm getting what is the temperature of this room or humidity of this room. But I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in current weather. Whether it's rainy, whether it's sunny, I go to AccuWeather, I try to work on that, right? So basically we need to analyze raw information, raw data to convert into intelligent form. Then only our product will work. We cannot just show that raw data on a mobile app and we are done. That is not IoT. We need to analyze raw data and convert it into some intelligent form. Then only we can say that product is IoT. But having said that, this is just generalized architecture. Now this architecture I cannot apply on every application. Let's say if I'm working in solar energy domain or environmental science or something else, the same architecture I cannot use. I need to customize this architecture according to my need. So let me talk about one of the problem actually I recently worked. And if you want to like find more details about this problem, there is a research paper link that is given here. I'll share that with, I think, Prasad sir and Jai sir, and he will share with you. So what I tried to work on air pollution monitoring system. So I this air pollution monitoring system actually I wanted to work on. So I use 5 different sensors here. DHT11 to get humidity and temperature, then CO sensor to get carbon monoxide value, then PM2.5 and 10 to get particulate matter data of surrounding environment, dust particles that is there. And I tried to work on 2 different sites, actually indoor site. So at my home, I installed this product, and then outdoor site at my terrace, I installed the same thing. Now for almost 90 days, I gather all the data that is coming through sensors. Then I give it to linear regression algorithm to predict certain pollution values that I'm getting. And based on that, I identify AQI index. AQI means air quality index. So some quantity value I want to give for particular pollution value. And then I try to classify them in healthy atmosphere, unhealthy, dangerous atmosphere, different type of atmosphere. Now, having said that, this is actually theoretical stuff that I'm telling. So this is actually application. So A is my input, that is sensors, and B is my output. So based on these layers, basically, this is my application where I'm seeing this. But as I said, I need to actually customize these layers. So now I've customized the same architecture into these layers that using sensors, I'm getting value. Now via some communication mediums here, I'm using Wi-Fi and I'm storing data on Google Firebase. So for 90 days, I store that data. Then I apply AI algorithm to analyze the information I got. And then I try to compare different sites. I try to get output for throughput of the system. I try to work on that power consumption part, that whenever this system is working, what kind of power different sensors are using. And then I try to work on a mobile app so that finally I want to know the actual PM2.5 10 value, that what is the actual pollution index of my room at my home as well as at my terrace. So this is an example how we can customize the same IoT architecture into some kind of a product. Now, this is an example how I've applied IoT in environmental science field. Now, one more example I want to talk about solar refrigerators. I work on something called smart solar refrigerator. So again, I published a research paper on that. So if you can go to this link, you'll find this. Now, I thought that if I want to work on smart solar refrigerator, then I only need solar energy, right? Just like current refrigerator requires electric power. Instead of that, if I provide solar energy, then this refrigerator will work. But here, challenge is very different. You know that sun rises in the east and moves towards west region. So basically, direction of sun will change. And when that will happen, I'll not get the similar amount of energy from sun. And if energy is not coming, then the items that are placed in this refrigerator will get affected. So what I did, I've used one solar collector. As you can see on my slide, there is parabola solar collector, which absorbs energy from the sun. Now I connected that with a motor. Motor is connected to LDR sensor. So now what that motor will do, whenever sun is changing, using LDR, actually this particular parabola is also moving in the sun's direction. So whenever sun will move from east to west, similarly, this parabola will move from east to west, so that I'll get the similar amount of solar energy for the solar refrigerator, so that the product that I've placed inside this should not get affected. And what LDR sensor will do, it will help me with daytime and nighttime. So if it is daytime, automatically this refrigerator will get energy from the sun. But if it is nighttime, it will again switch to the electric power. So it start getting electric energy and again it will switch to that solar part. So that is how this thing is working. So we actually developed this product at Symbiosis actually. So I've connected with one of faculty from mechanical engineering department and we work on this thing. So this is the architecture of the product that we propose. So what we try to do, some of the manual operations, we try to use some of the sensors like temperature, pressure, and some actuator valves, automated valves, to automate that particular thing. And then connected that with things, some of the ordinary, this different components of refrigerator, like water cooler, conditioner, and the evaporator, and different things are there. So this is how build of solar energy and mechanical, and we can find some solution. So any questions are there, you can ask me in between. Like I'm free to answer any kind of questions. So if any questions are there on couple of case studies I discussed, and if you want to read more, all these papers are already there. I'll share all the links with you and you can just go through it. Right. Yeah. So now let me come to some of the IoT technologies that we are working with. So I think Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, everybody knows. Am I audible now? So everybody's hearing now. Hello?
Yes, yes, yes.
So I think Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, everybody knows. Now, again, let me come back to the fundamentals. So I have one more question. When we say we are connected to Wi-Fi, But if I want to ask that how Wi-Fi is working, when you connect your mobile or laptop with Wi-Fi router, what is actually happening, what you're sending, or how that thing is working?
Yes,
so if anyone can answer.
Internet.
So basically there is nothing but just transmitter and receiver. So when a transmitter is sending some signal, now signal is a theoretical word, so that is not technically true. Actually what we are doing is a transmitter is actually vibrating electrons, and those electrons are receiving from transmitter to receiver. That is how this wireless thing is working. So that is how this Wi-Fi is actually working. So signal is again a theoretical word, it is not a technical word. But actually, these electrons which are being transmitted from one end to another end in form of the transceiver thing, and you guys are actually expert in that, because signal processing center actually I'm working with. So I just have limited knowledge about signal processing and all, but I only know that how this thing is working, so that I can do that interface. Similarly, Bluetooth we all know, but there is a new Bluetooth technology that is called BLE 4.0, that is called smart Bluetooth. So current Bluetooth technology we are using, if I use it in my mobile for, let's say, 2 hours or 3 hours, it will consume a lot of battery. But smart Bluetooth 4.0, it will not consume a lot of battery. So 1/10 battery it will consume, and still I can use Bluetooth. Just like that is happening in Aarogya Setu app currently, they are doing. Then there is some architecture used by industries called ISA, that is Industry Standard Architecture 100. So just like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth that we are using, there are so many other networking technologies are there that we are not part of, but IoT technologies are actually using this. Then there is something called Thread. That is a home automation network developed by Google. So Google Home product actually uses this network called Thread. Then there is something called Zigbee. So let's say recently I was working with one of my student group. We are working on smart street lighting. So what we wanted to do on highway, actually at night we waste a lot of energy. So we thought that whenever a car is moving, we should provide light at the front end part of the car, but at the back end part of the car, automatically it should be switched off. So we should keep some kind of IR sensor there. We should detect that object, and automatically that should be on and off. So we use this Zigbee network. Zigbee network says that, because we know that Bluetooth and Wi-Fi will have limited range. So I can cover maximum up to 1 kilometer or maximum up to 5 kilometer range if I use WiMAX. What if after 5 kilometer, I want to continue using that product? So just like we have wireless access point for a Wi-Fi, that we keep on increasing access point, we can keep on increasing Bluetooth or Wi-Fi nodes. And that is actually called Zigbee. So we can keep on increasing 100 kilometers range like this. And maybe we can connect Ahmedabad to Mumbai. So that 529 kilometers we can connect like this. So that's why the Zigbee is there. And Z-Wave is the small version of that Zigbee in similar fashion, because different companies are working on different networking technologies. So sometimes they are in competitions, so they work on different things. But Z-Wave has less data rate, and Zigbee actually has 128 kilobytes per second, actually we can send bits per second. Then ANT plus, it is called adaptive network technology. That is again a network used by industry for IoT. So now, yeah, one more thing I want to make it clear here. When we are doing experiments using NodeMCU, Arduino, Raspberry Pi, and we think that we are actually knowing IoT, that is wrong actually. The industrial setup of this IoT is very different. It is actually, there are different setup like IoT Link and different things are there. So they have a industrial sensors they're using for different things. So what we are doing now, that is just for research purpose or just to learn that thing, just for simulation and all. That the similar sensors and hardware are not being used by industries. So there is a gap there also, that the thing we are using is not being used by industries. The complete paradigm shift is there. So currently even I'm working with one of the company called Volkswagen actually. So after a week, I'm going to start training of their employees. They are actually from mechanical engineering, and they want to learn IoT and data science. So they approach us that you teach our employees how this data is, we can manage data, how we can analyze data, and those things they want to learn, because they are not from computer engineering background. So we are going to do that. So we also have some courses where we try to teach industries also that how these things are working and all. And last thing I want to talk about is IFTTT. There is an app available. If this, then what? It is 125 different channels are there. You guys can download that app, and you can do different things with that app. For example, you are entering your university and you want that your mobile should be connected to Wi-Fi of that university automatically, or when you reach your home, automatically it should switch to that Wi-Fi. So all those things you can configure here. You don't need to code anything. You just need to do such configuration, and automatically this app will configure and it will start working. such 125 such applications are given. You need to explore it more, this IEEE part. So these are some of the technologies, how it is working. Now, I think sir asked me, or one of the students asked me one question, that I'm using PIR sensor, then how it is motion-based sensor, how it is IoT thing. So basically what I did, I connected PIR sensor with IoT broker. So here, broker I've used is MQTT, Message Queuing Telemetry Transport Broker. Now in IoT, there is a lacuna, or there is a disadvantage. To connect two different ends, we need a broker architecture. IoT cannot work directly, because you understand that it is actually a combination of four different layers. So it is sensing layer, network layer, cloud layer, and application layer. So it's not easy to connect to these four layers. If I talk about security now, not a single security algorithm is available for IoT security right now. We talk about blockchaining, but blockchaining can only be applied on web data, cannot be applied on IoT. So currently there is a lot of scope. You guys can work on that, that not a single IoT security algorithm is available in the market. It's a very good PhD topic also. So basically we need a protocol called PubSub. It is called publisher and subscriber protocol, which connects two different ends. Let me take one example. Let's say I'm moving in my car and I want to navigate to a particular place. So I have navigation system in my car. Let's say Honda CR-V has that system. It has that LCD screen is there. And if that is connected to Wi-Fi or some technology, networking technology, I'm accessing that navigation system. And I'm telling that I want to move from A to B. It identifies that route for me and I'll go there. So basically, I'm a subscriber, I want a service, so I'll connect to one company. That company will provide me services, so that is publisher. So we need a broker architecture that provides, that connects publisher and subscriber. So two different end it connects. So if you want to use IoT, it is mandatory. You need to use this broker architecture. So these are some of the protocols that is being used in the industries. So MQTT is already discussed, that is public protocol. COAP is similar kind of protocol, that is private one. Similarly for Java and different things, you can see that different protocols are already available. So code for these protocols are already available. It's very easy to do that. It will just take 2 hours to connect this IoT gateway, and you can actually connect different things. So it is, there is no rocket science behind this. Anyone can just start with this, have basic knowledge of C or Python, can just start and just start connecting different ends. So one more example I want to discuss here. There is a new technology in the market that is known as connecting cars. So some issues are there, and currently I'm working on one of the issue also. Let's say if I'm moving in a car on a particular road. Now you know that sometimes turns are very strange and you don't know that which car is coming from which end. What if we have some technology which can connect inter cars and intra cars, and using some transceiver, I can come to know that a particular car is coming from the opposite direction from particular route where I'm going, and I can just change my route in advance so that I can protect my car from some kind of accident. Or let's say I'm working on one problem currently, that if someone will steal my car from my home, and if the I don't know who has stolen my car, and that person is on a road, met with an accident, and I don't know now what has happened to my car. But if I connect IoT technology, IoT and AI actually, with blockchaining, then blockchaining actually can work like a black box in a plane. So that blockchaining can store that particular state. So when that accident has happened, that will be stored, that will notify me that what has happened there, and I can take some actions. So this is how actually we can create khichdi of such technologies together and work on interdisciplinary solutions. So one of the right now problem is this inter-car thing. So it is known as connecting cars. And currently I'm working with Volkswagen. So they are going to launch their ambient car in the market in a year time. They have actually applied something called Industry 4.0 at their plant. So they automated 82% of their operations. And in 1 year time, you'll see that different ambient cars will come in the market. Now, what I mean by ambient? Let's say I'm at home. Let's say I'm in an air-conditioned room. So my body temperature would be different. Now, suddenly I'm going to my car, right? And I'm trying to control, means I'm trying to control my car. And I mean, I just enter my car and start the car. At that time, the car atmosphere is very different. So what will happen, my body has to adjust with the temperature of the car. So that is very difficult. So here, if we have some intelligent technologies there, which can actually measure your body temperature and try to change the temperature of the car automatically, that is called ambient thing. As I'm discussing car, so I can maybe play one video here. Actually, I worked on a Centro car also. So I had one idea that what if I can just, I can just connect to my car from my home using Wi-Fi. In summer it's very hot, so I can just start my car, switch on AC, and automatically I can just operate different features of the car sitting at home. So I worked on one of the Centro car actually, and I have actually published a patent on this thing. So I'll quickly play this video, just the introduction part. I'll try to switch. Just quickly see the introduction part. I'll just show you some of the features. In this project, then we cannot start the car, because car requires 35 ampere battery that is there with the engine. Now if that battery is off, I cannot operate this car. So what I did, just like you use power bank for your mobile, I actually placed two different power banks inside this car to give that initial ignition power. So when I'm giving Wi-Fi signal to this car, it is getting initial signal. Once that signal is once ignition is happening, automatically I start accessing the 35 ampere battery that is there in a car, and I can operate different features of the car. So I'll just quickly show you the demo. So let me just quickly. So I know that you cannot actually hear this, but I've started my car and I'm trying to use different features of the car, like car horn. So currently actually car horn actually I've played. Similarly, actually I can control power window of the car sitting at home via Wi-Fi. So I'll just quickly show you two things, how to operate power window as well as headlight of the car. So you can see that automatically power window started. Now there is a problem with this kind of thing. It will work in digital signal 1 and 0 only. So once I switch on, window will be on or off. I cannot stop it in between. And similarly, I got an idea that sometimes if we forget our car in a mall, and to find out where my car is, so if I can just switch on headlight of the car. So I can just do the same thing. But you might think that Tesla and Google is already working this kind of car projects and all. But I thought that in India, 70% cars are manual. So why to go for auto car? So I try to work with manual cars. So in manual car, actually nobody has done such kind of thing. That's why I actually patented this product also for myself. And I'm also working with a couple of companies to convert this into commercial product and to launch in the market also, right? So these were some of the examples I was discussing, that how this kind of problems actually can work on. So you should actually work on this kind of projects, interactive projects, and try to find some good solution, right? So any questions are there, what I've discussed? Then we'll talk about scope of IoT and what can be done and all. So if anybody's having any questions on what I've discussed about IoT, then I just need to take 5-10 minutes and we'll be finishing the session. Yeah, so any questions are there? So if you can just give me acknowledgement that if any questions are there. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So any questions are there if anybody's having? Because some of the concepts I covered, it's very important. So, and just we just need 5-10 minutes and I'm done.
I'm not able to see any questions in the chat box, sir. I mean, there are no questions.
Sure. So I'll continue.
Yes.
So now let's discuss the today's topic actually. What is the scope of IoT and AI actually? So not only IoT actually, I want to discuss AI also here. That what can be done? Because we all know that there are two different eras. Pre-corona is different and post-corona is different. So how we can actually work on different things? So I thought that I'm just a faculty or researcher at a particular research center and I cannot actually contribute. So I thought that if we have some app like Arogya Setu, which can actually help me using Bluetooth, that if someone is already infected, that is connected to some repository and I can come to know that what is happening. But I thought that why I cannot develop some more app where I can actually find something else than this one. So just like Arogya Setu, actually currently I'm working on one of the app actually, almost the work is done. So what I thought that if I can find direct and indirect suspect, so let me tell what actually I'm working on. So let's say I'm from Ahmedabad only actually. So I stay in Prahlad Nagar actually. So my parents are there. So let's say I'm in Prahlad Nagar and I'm moving and I want to know that a person that is around me, that person is affected by COVID-19 or not. So what I did, now assuming that I'm connected to repository of the patients, definitely, Without that, this app cannot work. So currently I'm presenting classical model of the same thing. Now, so what I did, I developed two different equations actually. I have submitted one research paper on this also. That let's say if I'm at a particular place and one person is very near to me, let's say 10 meter distance, one more person is there. Now I call that person, myself is COVID-19 individual, for example, and another person is neighboring individual. Then what I'll do, based on the coordinates, what I'll do, I'll try to find that this pattern is a, this particular person, because that person is coming near to me, is a direct suspect of COVID-19 for me. Now, when that person is meeting someone else, then that person will become indirect suspect. Getting now? So basically, currently what is happening, Arogya Setu can only tell me that who is already affected and I'm affected or not. But that is not enough, because we know that we need to live with corona. So I thought that when I'm moving around, I should know also that which are the directly suspected persons or indirectly suspected persons. So I work on this thing. So this particular screen is actually telling me that which are directly suspects. And then the if this person is meeting someone else, then I can come to know that this particular person is indirect suspect. So when I search in my app that on particular day in Prahlad Nagar, how many suspects were there? I'm not telling that that particular person is COVID-19 positive. I'm telling that that person is a suspect. So testing should be done for that person instead of everyone. So I can come to know on particular date how many suspects are there. How many direct and indirect suspects are there, I can easily come to know. And if I'm connected to patient repository, I can even identify their mobile numbers. So I know their mobile numbers as well as their coordinates, as well as total numbers also. And if I can give these numbers to government, they can actually use this database for doing different kind of testing. Rather than doing blind testing, this kind of testing can help government. That's why I thought that rather than thinking that I cannot contribute, let me start with something. So this was one of the things actually I worked on. Now, second thing I worked on that I thought that why I cannot develop a tool, a deep learning based and IoT based tool, where if I upload CT scan image or X-ray image, and I can actually come to know that a particular person is having corona or not. So here actually I worked on different things. So as you can see that I use X-ray and CT scan databases here. And I use different versions of CNN models. And I try to classify that whatever samples I'm giving internally, that person is COVID pneumonia affected or viral pneumonia affected, that I can actually identify. So let me just going through theory, I thought that let me show some demonstration. So actually I worked on, so let me first show you that database that I'm working on. So I got some data set from, actually I got Italian Society data set and one more data set from Kegel.com. I think everybody might be aware of Kegel. There is a repository where different data sets and everything is available. So different X-ray samples and image samples are there. So I'll just quickly search the data set. Now, I'm not a medical expert. So what I did actually, I also contacted a couple of doctors actually, so that because I need to annotate all the X-ray and CT scan images also. So I'll show you that almost 1000 different samples I got, and I trained a machine using different CNN versions like MobileNet, ResNet, ResNet 51, 101, DenseNet, and different things. So you can see that there are two different folders are there. So this particular folder is having samples of corona patients. So these are actually annotated by doctors, and you can easily see that in these samples, you can see cough with bulgum. So you can see that the chest part has, yes. Yeah, so any question is there? Hello?
No, that's a disturbance.
So you can see that on these different images, you can see that cough and bulgum. So the algorithm that I have developed actually, the algorithm can actually detect this, and based on that, it can classify that this particular patient is having probability of corona or just viral pneumonia. So these samples are actually annotated by doctors. These are actually corona samples that I gave it to machine. So you can see that different samples are there of different patients actually. Also actual patient repository. Actually Symbaz is also having our own hospital. So I also got actual samples of that also. I can show you also if I have, yeah. So you can see that this database of actual patients actually. So a particular patient right now there in the hospital, we are doing research for them. So this particular person that checks, So our university actually provided the samples to do research actually. So different samples are there. This particular person is corona positive actually. And we also have their annotation. So that patient name and all the details I have. And these details actually I gave it to this machine learning algorithm. So I actually worked on, as I said, different versions of CNN actually. And if time permits, now I'll show you one more case study. I worked on acoustic classification also using deep learning. So this is Inception V3 algorithm. So you can see that these are different samples actually. So actually I got almost 250 COVID-19 samples and then I apply augmentation. So I got more images. So currently you can see that I have two categories. One is pneumonia and corona. So if class is zero, that's viral pneumonia. Otherwise it is corona. So already like this work is done with two, three radiologists actually, one from China actually, I'm connected, and one from India also. I'll show you that research paper also. And you can see that I got almost 98% accuracy. And then what I thought actually, that I'm actually working on this kind of tool. So if I'll just upload CT scan or chest X-ray images like this, then this particular tool will give probability score. So according to my tool, actually I've followed ICMR guidelines. So whatever guidelines issued by ICMR, based on that, my tool will give that if probability score is if more than 1% also, I'll say that this particular person is COVID-19 positive based on the data and machine learning and the training we did. Based on that, so I also tried to apply this on myself also, the training and all to identify, because I thought that rather than telling others, let me do clinical experiment on myself and then I'll try to do for others, right? So this is an example how AI and IoT combination can be applied on a post COVID-19. So how actually we can develop solutions for ourselves. So you can see that here also, I did some segmentation also. So from this particular image, I can even come to know that which parts are affected, not affected, different things I can come to know. So all this data actually I got from different doctors actually. So I'll quickly show you that one of the paper I've written actually, that is known as radiologist in the loop machine learning system. So I thought that I'll try to contribute in some way. So submitted this in one of the journal called Medical Imaging. It is under review actually. But I try to work on developing a system which can actually assist radiologists. So I'm not telling that we can replace, a machine learning can replace doctors. But what I've tried is we can enhance performance of different doctors here. Yeah, so you can see that. Yeah, one more information I can give you. In medical journals, only first and last author names are important. So whenever you are publishing papers and all, generally first and last author names are the ones. So you can see that I'm working with some of the research scientists from Denmark, Germany, and so some of them from India and some of the radiologists from actually MP, from Pune, you can see that from UK. So we are working together on this kind of problems so that we can, if we can develop some kind of solution. So I'll just quickly show you my model that I've developed. So this you already seen that 9 different machine learning algorithms we tried to classify this, but this is not difficult actually. Nowadays already even AI for medicine Coursera course is available. So this thing is not difficult to do. The difficult part is the annotation part. So these are some of the ROC values, region of curve values and all that we got for our application. So these are some of the medical terms actually. I got help from different doctors. So we try to extract different features of lung, chest and throat and all. And we try to extract these features and give it to our ML box. So we call it our algorithm as RILML, that is radiologist in the loop machine learning system. And we try to classify them in COVID-19 pneumonia or viral pneumonia. So this is our algorithm, how it's working. So we also have medical imaging center at Symbiosis. So medical imaging center along with applied AI center, we are working together on providing some kind of solution. And we also got some support from the Maharashtra government also on working on this kind of issues. So you can see that I can show some annotation that how this particular app is working. So this is when this is highlighted, you can see that the highlighted areas actually machine learning algorithm is identified and it is also telling me that which are the affected areas and its impact also, that what is the probability score and everything is coming based on this kind of CT scan images. So generally, when we are not able to detect based on X-ray, we go for CT scan. So these are some of the results, and then I try to compare that if a radiologist will do something. Now let me take one example. Like, do not take it negatively, but I always think that a GP, a medical GP, is not required, because when I meet GP, what that person will do? Look at my eye, my tongue, and different things, and try to do predictive analysis. Right? That person, whatever that person has learned in MBBS, try to apply that knowledge and try to give me solution. But that is also predictive analysis. So what if I'll give the same data to a machine learning algorithm? It will give me 10%, like 10 times more result than a GP can give. So I thought that machine learning can perform better than a GP doctor. But radiologists we cannot replace, because they are specialized in their area. They have done MD, PhD, and they actually got a lot of insights. So, but we can give the similar insights to a machine learning algorithm, and can machine learning algorithm can perform well also. We got almost 97% accuracy in this model also. So this is the confusion matrix that we got, and different assessment is there. And then there are some limitations of the system also that currently we are working on. So currently, one thing I have to tell, that when you're working on deep learning algorithm, now you might get 92%, 95% accuracy, but that is not true accuracy. When you apply this product in real time, you can only get accuracy up to 70%. So that we have discussed in this paper also, that how this accuracy is different from regular accuracy that is happening. Right. So I'm almost done with my session. So these are some of the IoT certifications I did from MBA, IBM, and different companies actually. And these are actually IBM IoT trainer certifications. So if you want to become trainer, then these are the certifications, right? And if you want to do like you want to work in a company as an IoT specialist, then these are some more certifications that is available on IBM website already. There are so many different certifications are there. Even I aspire to do some of the certifications, which is connected to my research area. So these are some more certifications you can see. I'll share all this certification, I think, with Prasad sir and others, and they'll share with you, right? So if you have any kind of questions, you can ask me, or you can just post queries on my email address. I'll be happy to answer those things. So thank you very much for everything and listening.
So participants, if you have any questions, please do post in the chat box.
Yeah.
And before we could wind this up, I request all the participants to make sure that you drop down your mail IDs along with your full names in the chat box for certificates and feedback.
So anyone can ask me any questions if you're related to whatever I've covered, or any new idea you're working on, or anything. Maybe if I can be of some help or something, or we can work together on something.
So the participants, if you have any questions, please do in the chat box. Please do post in the chat box. And before we could wind this up, I request all the participants to make sure that you drop down your mail IDs along with your full names in the chat box for certificates and feedback. And thank you, everyone. I would give my special thanks to Dr. Sharmil Pandya sir for giving us very valuable time and sharing us such an important information that would help students and also many others in several ways. Thank you once again, sir, for being with us here today. It was really such an informative session. I hope this seminar was extremely useful. And thank you all for your wonderful participation. Hope the same continues. And a YouTube link of our channel will also be provided in the chat box. Do subscribe it.
Sure, sir. I'll share the link.
Yes.
Sure, sir. I'll share that YouTube link actually.
For many more such informative webinars. Thank you.
Yes, sure, sir. Such 15-20 videos are there on different things are there, like car automation, home automation.